What is the response to Mr. McCullough's primetime news conference explaining why there was not an indictment of Mr. Wilson concerning killing Michael Brown? We're going to look at that during this program. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice with the rest of the story. I believe it's important that we understand the frustrations, understand the hopelessness that many in the community feel at this particular time, and understand the reason why we need to go before God, asking us how to pray, when to pray, where to pray, and exactly what to pray about. These are perilous times, times in which the people of God need to go before God and pray and open their hearts and minds for a full understanding. Since other stations went out of their way to provide primetime coverage to Mr. McCullough and his news conference as to why an indictment did not take place, I felt it was important that we'd also hear from representatives of the family of Michael Brown and also Al Sharpton, giving them an opportunity to express themselves. You may not agree with everything that is said, but it's important that we hear and we learn and we open ourselves up to understand the rest of the body of Christ, brothers and sisters in Christ. I was certainly shocked when I first met Michael Brown Sr., shocked by his deep faith, shocked by his desire to see that there would not be violence take place, and surprised at his deep faith and compassion, even in the tragic loss of his son. Although he did not directly speak up at the news conference that you're about to hear, he did share with me some things that you'll hear at the end of the program. So let's listen. And let's learn.
Good afternoon. I'm Attorney Benjamin Cross, along with my co-counsel, Attorney Anthony Gray, and Attorney Darrell Parks, and Attorney Hamilton, President of the National Bar Association. We will initially address this press conference, the family's response to the announcement by the prosecutor yesterday. Reverend Al Sharpton and Michael Brown Sr. will call and address you after the attorneys make their comments. Michael Brown Sr. will say very little because he doesn't want to misspeak because of such emotions that are going through him that relate to be held against him. And so with that said, we will take a few questions after that agenda is completed, and we will try to respect the family of Michael Brown Jr. and Ms. Moses. Cheryl's unforgiving hours that they are facing. Attorney Gray and Attorney Darrell Parks and myself, we objected back in August to this prosecution. We even wrote a letter to Governor Jay Nixon requesting a special prosecutor to be appointed. We objected when he informed us the process that he was going to use that was different than anything else, different than any normal grand jury that you would have presented. And now, after we watched him last night in his comments, we strenuously objected to this prosecutor and this process. But this morning, after we, like all of you, went through as much of the information, I think it was described as a data dump, we went through as much of it as we could and saw how completely unfair this process was. We object publicly and loudly as we can on behalf of Michael Brown Jr.'s family that this process is broken. The process should be indicted. It should be indicted because of the continuous systematic results that is yielded by this process. And let's be very honest about this process. We have the local prosecutor who has a symbiotic relationship with the local police and the local police officers who sit in judgment whether to indict the police when they brutalize or kill a young person from our community. And normally, that prosecutor has no relationship or no regards for the young person of color. And so, as Attorney Gray and Attorney Parks predicted at the beginning, we could foresee what the outcome was going to be. And that's exactly what occurred last night. But it is awfully troubling when you look at what was released and you hear about the police officer who shot Michael Brown Jr. in broad daylight, the unarmed teenager, and you hear he testified for 4 hours, and you had to scratch your head, kind of like we all did, to say, when is the prosecutor going to cross-examine the killer of an unarmed person? A first-year law student would have did a better job of cross-examining the killer of an unarmed person than the prosecutor. I mean, where was it vetted? Where was his veracity ever challenged? Where was his credibility ever challenged when you watch those 4 hours that he got to give a speech to this grand jury? You know, he told the detective testified, he told me he got hit 10 times, violently. He told the grand jury he only got hit 2 times. But he said, and you all heard it, holding against a 5-year-old. Nobody questioned, well, officer, you're 6'4", you were 226 pounds. Michael Brown is 6'6", he wears 292 pounds. You mean to tell me that he hit you with such force that you were describing that it was gonna knock you out, it was gonna knock you unconscious? And nobody held up the pictures to say, but that's not consistent with the physical evidence. Reverend Al, we object to this process because all across America, President Mings, whether it's in New York, Los Angeles, California, Cleveland, young people of color are being killed by police officers, and the local prosecutors put together this fair and unbiased grand jury, and it continues to yield the same results. Now, I've been told, Mr. Mario, that if you continue to do the same thing over and over again and expect a different result, then that is the definition of insane. And we can say to the prosecutor, we are not insane. We know that our children deserve equal justice, just as any American. And we want the prosecutors, if they have a conflict of interest, and for the sake of the public trust, which is so critical to persons in many communities all over America, President Brooks, we pray that prosecutors will say, we want people to believe in the system. And if that means appointing a special prosecutor who has no relationship with the accused officers, that you do so. The legacy of Michael Brown Jr. should be one not where we just make a lot of noise, Mr. Brown. That's where to leave the proper legacy to your son. The legacy to Michael Brown Jr. should be that instead of just striving to make a lot of noise, we strive to make a difference. Yeah, right. And that difference will be changing this system where the police who are supposed to protect and serve us continue to kill our members and our community. And we have to really address this issue as one that, what scenario could we offer when they finally indict police officers for killing us. Isn't that a real question? So, as we made great here from Attorney Brady and Reverend Allen and Mr. Brown and Kirk and Ford, we beg you all again that we know it's frustrating, that we know that it's painful. It's painful to anyone, especially parents of young people of color. We worry about our children every day. I mean, every day when we hear they have an encounter with the police around there, I mean, our heart just stops. And it shouldn't be like that. We should be able to expect the police to treat our children just like they treat any other children in any other community. And so, to hopefully really address this issue, we want to propose for the Michael Brown law. That is a proposal that every police officer in every American city has a video body camera.
Yeah.
So it will be transparent. And we won't have to play this game of witnesses, memories, and secret grand jury proceedings. It'll just be transparent. And we can see it for ourselves. And we can hold people accountable when they have interactions with citizens, because this system is so unfair to the citizens. And we are all American citizens. And we ask that everybody, not just the entire St. Louis community, but all of America, join us in demanding change, making a difference for the lives of our children and for the sake of our communities, and especially for Michael Brown Jr., who is crying out from the grave of so many thousands of other people of color that have been killed by the police, saying, "You all have to change the system." Attorney Gray.
I mean, I'll be very brief. I just want to remind everybody present and so eloquently call on to stand on the very beginning. As a city of this land, it's going to be the direct reflection of the presentation of evidence about our city. If they present evidence to indict, those are the indictments,
right?
If they don't present evidence in a manner to secure the indictment, then there won't be an indictment. So this grand jury decision, we feel, is a direct reflection of the sinfulness of those that presented the evidence. We appreciate the negative. We appreciate the fact that we got a chance to hear or read all of this testimony. We saw what was presented, but we didn't hear how it was presented.
Right.
We didn't get a chance to hear the inflection in the voice and the cynicism and the sarcasm. And some of the questions that I read just jump off the page at you. So it's all of the presentation of evidence, and I don't want anybody to be this way in any other way. I'll also caution all of the people that we still have an ongoing investigation. I'm not going to comment on very much of the evidence at all. I'm just going to ask that you have transcripts, you for yourself. As I read the testimony of one person, Officer Dan Wilson, he indicted himself. Also, when he said that line up with the physical, he didn't look at himself. It's right there in front of your face. And you know, there's an old adage that some people say, you really want to hide something.
Right.
It's right there for us.
Right.
Now, I'm just going to encourage the ongoing investigators to continue to do what they have to do. And we will hold our hope that subsequent investigations would produce a result that reflects the way that happens. I would only say to you that over 50 witnesses and only 4 to 5 of them. What was the other 55 for? If you already know going into it that a person didn't see the event, they already told you that.
That's
not being presented to the
grand jury. That's right.
That's right.
That's right.
So it's things like that that we're raising on. power that at some point justice will be served, and you will at least have a presentation of evidence that's fair and impartial. And then we will allow the chip to fall where you may. Without any further ado, I'm going to give you Mr. Al Sharpton.
Three days after Michael Brown Jr. was killed, we had a major rally in this very church. He said that night, with his parents present, that he had little to no faith in the grand jury by the local district attorney. He said that night that he wanted the federal government to come in. That Sunday we had a unity rally where thousands came and joined. He repeated that all the way through the funeral without the unity rally. Last night, the appearance by the district attorney made it clear to everyone why we had little faith in the state prosecution. I've been out getting involved in civil rights all my life. We have seen cases go ways that we felt were right and ways that we felt were wrong. I've never seen a prosecutor hold a press conference to discredit the victim.
That's right.
To go point by point in discrediting Michael Brown, who could not defend himself. How do you, in explaining why you are not indicting a man to kill, try and convict a young man for shoplifting that can't explain it to you? Try to convict him for interfering in the police car when you don't hear his side of the story. Have you ever heard a prosecutor go in a press conference and explain to the press why the one that did the killing is not going to trial, but the victim is guilty of several things that go on? He takes his time to methodically try and discredit the witnesses.
Right.
Witnesses that will still be needed going forward in the ongoing federal investigation and in their civil proceedings. What is the purpose of Mr. McCullough trying to undermine the credibility of the witnesses, undermine the credibility of the victim? Still has not explained to us how you have a man on the force that feels like he's a child of a young hokey. So what kind of training and policing do you do? And still has not explained the original altercation began over what in the first place and why he in turn fired the fatal shot. Let us not forget that only one that makes a presentation in the grand jury is the prosecutor. There is no cross-examination. So for him to talk about inconsistencies is unchallenged because there's no one representing the other side to come and cross-examine the consistent is only responding to what was asked. If there was two sides, then maybe some of the gaps would have been filled. But when you have the attitude of a prosecutor that feels it is his duty to go out of his way to try to discredit a young teenager that can't speak for himself, then America saw why we said from day one the federal government needs to step in to protect the rights of Michael Brown.
That's right.
And to protect the rights of the citizens.
That's right.
It also was very strange to us that he lectured the media a media that he and others had no problem when you leave the video tape for back to back in the video store or in the convenience store. A media that you had no problem leaking all kind of favorable stuff for the prosecution.
That's right.
A media you had no problem leaking things for the officer. So it seems to me that he has had the use of the media. Then has a strange decision in a town that has been tense, in a town that has been forecast to have all kinds of problems. His solution is, let's announce it at night after dark. Let's make sure that all the kids are home, that all of the students are back for Thanksgiving break, and it's dark outside.
Yeah.
And we're going to announce it, and then I'm going to get up in the dark.
In the dark.
And castigate the character Michael Brown Jr. I think that it was irresponsible.
Yeah, yeah.
I think that it was unnecessarily provocative.
Yeah.
But I think it only cleared why many of us said, let's go to the federal government from the first place.
Right.
He implied last night that the federal government and the state investigation ran hand in hand and ended last night. That is not the case.
That's right.
The Attorney General has released a statement saying the federal government investigation continues in the killing and in the review. And Mr. McCullough's statements last night led others to believe differently. Let me be very clear that we were not surprised at what the outcome was.
That's right. That's right.
Certainly it is painful for the mother and father. Certainly there will be emotional reaction. I've never seen a case where there wasn't. You deal with their flesh and blood. But let the record be clear. You have broken our hearts.
Yeah.
But you have not broken our backs.
Yeah.
So we are going to continue to pursue justice. And this is not a Ferguson problem.
No.
There's a grand jury about a week or two away from deciding the Choco case in New York. There's a 12-year-old that was just killed by police in Cleveland. This is a problem all over the country. Right now, 12 noon all over the country, people are marching and gathering in front of the federal courthouse. Mass Action Network, NLEC, that's urban league, all of our members are coming out, empowerment movement. Today, on the Saturday, we'll be all over the country. We will continue to fight for a new level of accountability of policing.
That's right.
Michael Brown will not be remembered for the ashes from buildings burned in Ferguson. He will be remembered for new legislation and the upholding of the law. Remind you, for over 100 days, young people, older people,
right,
people of all races marched and rallied in this city.
Right. That's right.
And they did it peacefully,
right,
non-violent.
Right.
Yes, those that got violent last night, those that acted in a destructive manner, does not represent the spirit of Michael Brown. It was those young people, those old people, that stood no matter what the weapon for over 103 days. They kept going. Those are the ones that have stood for Michael Brown. They're on Brown's side. Those that burned are on their own side. If you're on Michael Brown's side, you walk with dignity. If you're on Michael Brown's side, you stand up with pride and call the uphold the law. If you do anything to harm others, you're on your own side. You're not on Brown's side.
Yeah, right.
We are on the side of Michael Brown.
Yeah.
Right for what is right. Don't know what goes on. In that light, we also question how you have grand juries now that are proud children.
Wow.
The use of a grand jury is to find out if there is probable cause to go to trial.
That's it.
You do not have a grand jury to decide on the guilt or innocence of the accused. You only decide, is there enough to go for? You have a deceased body, this person did it, their accusation, he contradicts him, it goes to trial.
Right.
The fact that last night, the prosecutor was not announcing whether there was probable cause. He was announcing the acquittal.
Right.
Of the officer.
He
was lying to him. And that is a miscarriage and a misuse of the grand jury system.
I'm talking to Michael Brown, Sr. When you got word of your son's death, tell us, it must have been the most tragic moment of your whole life.
No, it was devastating. I couldn't believe it. When I got to the scene, I still can't believe it because he was covered up. But reality started hitting me after the days that went past that I wasn't able to talk to him.
How are you coping with all this personally?
God.
Is God's given you the strength?
God has given me the strength.
What do you say to God?
Thank you.
Thank you for the strength to keep on going.
Yes, sir.
I mean, this is going on and on. It's all over the world right now.
Yes.
We couldn't have ever imagined anything like that.
Right.
Do you see some good coming out of all this?
I always have faith in good. Uh-huh. Everyone knows that was wrong. Hopefully he has some type of feeling himself to at least admit that he was wrong, turn himself in, do the right thing. But I have faith that everything will work in favor.
Talking to Michael Brown, Sr., tell us about your son, Michael Brown, Jr.
Well, he was just an average teenager, you know. He liked to play sports, hang out, talk to girls, wear nice shoes, name brand shoes, dress up, movies, got his permit to drive, you know, just an average teenager, you know, just trying to find himself in his own way, you know.
When you think about this police officer did this, what thoughts go through your mind?
Just why. That's all. Why.
How do you find it in your heart to deal with this? I mean, or to be able to implement the message of love, forgiveness. How do you do that at a time like this?
To be honest, I'm empty inside, so I really don't have any feelings, but I know what I have to do to keep this fight going in a positive way to get justice for my son.
That's what you're going to continue to do?
Yes, sir. To the day I die.
We've got to have some faith that there's going to be some justice in the system.
Don't that's
we?
All. That's
so
all.
That faith keeps going on.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
And again, I want to ask you to please keep Michael Brown's family in your prayers at this time. Put yourself in that situation. Yes, if you, it could, please put yourself in that situation.
Do.
Understand, you're talking about a human being. And a lot of people, they can't comprehend. I mean, you never dreamt in your wildest dreams something this like
this. Yes,
please.
I wouldn't want this for no one, child. You know, especially didn't think the devil would be mine. So, no.
God bless you for your strength that you're continuing to demonstrate at this hour in a very special way. God bless you. And may God bless those who are standing with him at this hour. What does it mean to you to have the people support you like this, pray for you, and encourage you?
I thought you had something to say.
It's beautiful. It makes it a little easier, you know.
Does it? Just to know that they're standing with you.
Yeah, it makes it a little easier.
I want to ask you to continue to keep Michael Brown's family in your prayers and just gathering here, people standing up, standing in solidarity, praying, believing God for justice, right?
For justice for everyone around the world, not just for Michael Brown.
Right.
Everyone.
So many right now. So many that are dying, so many stolen lives, praying for justice. And thank God for those that are doing just that.